worked, and here we are. Yay. Hi, guys.
Hi, everyone.
Now, listen, normally we're always at 8 p.m., but tonight was the Rose O'Donnell show. We knew that so many people that love the Actors Fund was watching it, so we began at 9 p.m., but tomorrow night we are back at 8 p.m. By the way, with Chairman of the Board, Mr. Brian Stokes Mitchell. So we're back 2 p.m., 8 p.m. tomorrow. Okay, I'm Seth Rudetsky, James Wesley, go.
Welcome to Stars in the House. Today is Andrew Lloyd Webber and Stephen Sondheim's birthday, but because there's so much material, Andrew Lloyd Webber is going to be celebrated tomorrow. Matinee.
Yeah.
Anyway, everyone, please share this on YouTube or Twitter or Facebook.
You don't share on YouTube.
Oh, I don't know.
Okay, so any social media you have, just put this link on your Facebook, your Twitter. The more people that are watching, the money we've been raising is crazy. We just began Monday night, but a lot of people are still like, I never heard of this. So the more you share this, the better. And that way more people can be donating.
Our goal is really close to, we're like at $80,000.
We're so close to 100. We just began Monday night. We're so close to $100,000. By the way, any people that connected with corporations, we do like a matching thing. Like if we raise $100,000, you guys match it. And just FYI, the Actors Fund, not just for actors, musicians, ballet dancers, modern dancers, they never make money no matter what.
All of the professional arts organizations across the country are being severely impacted. So this money that's being raised, it isn't just, it's a misnomer that it's only actors. That's number one. Number two, there's maybe a misconception that it's only people in Los Angeles or the big cities or New York. It's not true. It's all over. So we're talking about opera companies, ballets, symphonies all across the nation.
And everyone that works for them. So people backstage, people that do wardrobe, box office, ushers. We have these, you know, our friends that are wedding singers in Texas. They're not working. Everyone can go to the Actors Fund and get help. You donated starsinthehouse.com.
Right. So let's... Speaking of raising money, so in our after matinee show, Joanna Gleason was one of many of our stars, and she surprised us with...
it was a Sondheim celebration. She held this up.
Yeah.
First, we were like, what the hell is that? A dead snake. But it's not. It's literally the original staff that Bernadette Peters held in Into the Woods as the witch. And when Joanna left the show, they gave her that original staff, and she said, I think it's time to auction it for the Actors Fund. So we started, you can actually write to us. What's the email address?
It's starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. Seth will try to find it. So we've already had, I can't tell you how many bids, 500 up to 1,000. And one smart person said, my bid is $1,026.
Remember like on The Price is Right, $1,027.
Exactly.
So anyway, so just keep it going up. And the fact is already up to 1,000 and barely anyone even knows about it.
So Joanna gave everyone who wants to bid on it until the end of the week. So actually, I guess a week from today, we'll have the winner and we'll have Joanna back.
Yes, queen.
Okay.
What's next?
Seth, we had Melissa Gilbert and her husband, Tim Busfield, on the other, was that just last night?
Last night with Kristin Chenoweth. They surprised Kristin Chenoweth.
So they have a house up in the Catskills and they've decided to be creative artists and start a podcast that involved cooking. I don't know.
It's cooking combined with Little House on the Prairie and 30-something. And it's on iTunes. And
but it's not even intentional.
No, it just worked out that way.
It's like, it looks like they live in a house that's built in Little House in the
Prairie. Gilbert, Melissa Gilbert, and Busfield Podcast on iTunes. So you have to get it. We're going to have Melissa back on and Tim. So anyway.
So another fundraiser, our friends at Lights of Broadway.
Yes.
Yes. Squiggs has designed a card with all of the profits going to the Actors Fund. There it is.
It's just $10. It's Lights of Broadway cards are beautiful. It's just $10. All the proceeds go to the Actors Fund. So go to the Lights of Broadway. You know that amazing website where they're so beautiful. Go to the Lights of Broadway. Look it up. Get that card. It is just $10. It's so, and by the way, it's limited edition and it's going to go to the Actors Fund. So please get that. So much to say.
I know. Well, and because we're all having to find our ways like Tim and Melissa, Julie has been doing.
Oh, yeah. Julie gets commissioned to do art and she made this video. Because we're all trying to be creative. Right. This is actually really keeping our sanity doing these shows twice a day. It's ruining our marriage, but keeping our sanity doing the shows twice a day.
All right. Well, if you're going to admit that, Seth, that's so bad. Seth and I joke that, you know how in I Love Lucy, that, you know, it's so much fun. And then, especially for those of us who watch it in reruns,
obsessively,
that you don't, you know, that the show, when they moved to the country, that's the end of the marriage. But because those I Love Lucy episodes were like hour long, maybe like four a year until 1960. And I think the very last one was like the day before their divorce. And so Seth and I-
So it's a lot of joking on camera. And then turns the cameras off, hate each other. And when this is over, divorce. Anywho,
it's not true, but it's funny.
We wanted to anyway. Julie made this creative video. She got a commission she got a commission to paint the dog.
Okay,
she made this video. Look. Bravo, Julie!
Yes.
Okay, what the hell's next?
Well, we have this letter that I really I got choked up about. Here it is. Wow, there's a couple here. Here we go. So we've been getting a lot of emails, and this one particularly stuck out. Dear Seth and James, since I am a great fan of Broadway but live in the Netherlands, I rely on my Broadway content from YouTube. This is how I found your Stars in the House shows. The corona crisis has hit hard here, too. All performances are canceled here, and it's heartbreaking. Although I'm an amateur singer, I have a lot of professional singer friends who have now lost their income, and I'm worried for them. We have no Actors Fund here. It is very special what you do, and even though the Actors Fund doesn't reach overseas, I do feel connected to you and sharing the community feeling that is theater. I am inspired by and grateful for the work you do with this series. Thank you, Eva. That actually reminds me, we don't have it, but tell about the Canada email you got.
Oh yeah, we just found out that this series is not going to be done in Canada. They said, inspired by Seth and James, they're starting their own live stream series to help the Actors Fund in Canada. So this is just, sadly, this is just for America. I mean, it's hard, man. Everyone's out of work everywhere. But we really are so lucky that the Actors Fund exists. They don't have it in the Netherlands. Entertainers are out of work, and that's it. You can turn to the Actors Fund to help you with no matter what you do in the business.
And use this platform, StreamYard.com, where I always say we're not paid spokesmen, StreamYard.com. And I was talking to Len Carriou and Heather after the show this afternoon, and they were saying their great nephew was like just about to graduate and perform up in Canada. And so they were going to encourage him to do something similar with his
classes. It's a great way to get money. All right, we've got to introduce our star.
Well, hold on. We have a few. I know we have a lot here, but there's a few donations.
Oh, yeah, we got to do the donations.
These are left over from the matinee Sondheim show. Rachel from New Jersey, $25. Taylor from Michigan, $155. Tessa from Wisconsin, $50. Rick from New York, $25. Stephen from Connecticut, $25. Eva from New York, $25. And Jay from Florida, $50. Thank you so much.
Okay, we got to introduce our chief medical correspondent, right? Is that correct?
Absolutely.
As we always do, the amazing Dr. John LaPook.
Hi, Dr. Hey, guys.
By the way, we love seeing you on CBS this morning, not only pitching us, but it was the exact same background. We're like, oh, my God, we know that look.
This is me at home. Yeah. So I was in self-quarantine for a very low-risk exposure. That happened 14 days ago, and I got sprung today at noon.
What did you do to celebrate?
I took a walk in Central Park, and 6 feet away from everybody, it was interesting to see the dance that was going on there. I was with my son. But it was wonderful to get out. It's a beautiful day. And, you know, the little things, we've been talking about this. This is a time where, you know, you don't want to be too much of a Pollyanna looking at silver linings, but people are appreciating things. They're slowing down. They're thinking about the moment. They're thinking about their loved ones. I loved your reference to Lucy. Lucy, I'm wondering if we could raise some money selling some Vitamita Vegemin.
Wait, by the way, Dr. John LaPook, the one thing I would love you to talk about, and then we'll bring you back later, is basically a lot of people I've spoken to today are sort of overwhelmed and feel like this is going to be their whole life. So can you just yet again reassure people that this is just like a period we have to go through?
It is. I know it's very hard when you're in the middle of it. But my spiel on this will have a beginning, a middle, and an end. I promise it will have an end. Are we at the end of the beginning right now? Where exactly are we? That's what's so disquieting, right? And nobody likes being out of control. But that's the reason for the social distancing, right? Because that gives us some control. Right now, there are a lot of different forces that are happening. We talk about flattening the curve. We have all these cases happening at once. And if we could just make them happen over a little bit of a longer period of time and not hit the healthcare system at once, we can really make a difference. I heard today from one of my buddies who is a surgeon at one of the hospitals here. He's really worried about the lack of equipment, the lack of protective equipment, lack of ventilators and all that. At the same time, we heard from the president today that, you know, that corporations are stepping up, that we're getting private sector making masks. I love the fact that factories that make cars or what else, that they're going to be trying to be repurposing and making ventilators. You know, when you think about it, World War II, we were turning out, after Pearl Harbor, we were turning out ships. we can do this together. Again, it's not to be a Pollyanna. We're in for a bumpy ride, but we will get through this. But here's the punchline. People, we have to get through it together. And again, we're still seeing some young people who are out there congregating, thinking they're immune to this. You're not. Not only can you get sick yourself, even if you're in your 20s, 30s, and 40s, but you can pass it on to people who are older and more vulnerable. This is a time where we have to think of everybody, not just of ourselves. So that's kind of my spiel. And later we can talk about when people are feeling alone and lonely. This is what this is all about, as we're physically separated, trying to be emotionally connected. And I want to talk later about how you talk to kids.
By the way, look at this, Dr. John Cook. Look how, where'd it go? Look how great this is. A big hello from 1,000 miles away in Singapore. It's 9 a.m. here. Thank you for doing what you do. It's such a wonderful initiative. So they love that. And on top of that, they also love my favorite episode.
She was kind of looped by the end of that, wasn't she?
It was acting. All right, we're going to bring you back. Bye, Dr. John.
We'll see you soon.
Bye. Okay, because it's Sondheim's birthday, we're going to bring a man who made his Broadway debut in a Sondheim musical. I'm such an incredible fan of him, like such a brilliant actor, comedian, amazing singer, does not sing enough on Broadway. I'm furious about it.
And I can't tell you how excited Seth was when this man said yes.
I can't. I'm just completely obsessed. Please welcome Mr. Jason Alexander.
Hi.
What great placement. That was a G.
Right. That's my warm up. That's how I warm up here at the house.
You got it. Okay. So James has this signature question he always, by the way, this is your house you're in right now, right?
This is our den. I've got the fire going beside me. It's fantastic.
So Jason, we ask everyone during this time, what are you doing to stay healthy?
Why would now be different from any other time? Do I look like the poster child for health to you?
Well, it can be mental.
Food. I drink myself to oblivion. That we know. I'm sure I'm doing what everyone else is doing. It's a little easier to eat right. I'm probably eating better now than I do normally because I'm not going out to restaurants and grabbing things on the fly. I work out with my trainer, bless his heart. I have a little gym upstairs, and we do the Skype thing 3 times a week, and so he tries to keep me going. And then
social distance.
You know, my wife and I are here in the house, and we decided we're going to redo a room a week. We're going to Marie Kondo, then we're going to straighten, then we're going to clean, then we're going to paint, then we're going to whatever it needs to be done. We're doing a room at a time. And my kids, both my boys are out of the house, but one lives 15 blocks that way and the other is 15 blocks that way. So we Skype and we do, you know, we have picnics in the backyard and we stay away from each other, which is how I treated them for their entire childhood.
Oh, yeah, no. I read their books. Daddy dearest. Jason, Dr. John LaBucca was saying it's very important to keep in touch with loved ones and friends when you're separated. And here's someone you are separated with, but I know that you love. Please welcome your good pal, Ms. Cheetah Rivera. Yeah!
And I didn't recognize you because you weren't in drag.
For you, I can be in drag, Cheetah, anytime, baby. The wig is standing by.
Well, you were gorgeous in drag. I loved it.
Bless you.
And you guys had so much fun of just giggling, and we were supposed to be serious, and of course, we were not.
We were not.
You're in the rink?
I learned how to roller skate, which, and I still have the bruises to prove. I suffered for that show.
You sang so beautifully.
Only to you.
Marry me.
Marry me. Come on and marry me.
Oh, yeah.
You. I talk about you. I do a one-man show where I answer questions all the time about my career, and you come up on everyone, and I glow over you. I tell the story about this amazing thing you did one time when Liza was out and missed a show, and you became my role model for how to be a real professional in this business. And I always say, when I grow up, I want to learn how to be Cheetah Rivera. And I still believe that.
Well, the secret is not growing up.
That's true. And you've nailed that.
I have seriously nailed it.
I want to remind you guys how cute you were when you were doing the show together. Look at that. There's Jason all the way over there.
Hey. Yes. Yes. Look at that girl.
Well, yeah. I mean, I look 12 in that picture.
And you guys, you were probably... Yeah, she didn't know, but I wonder if you guys know. Who was my understudy in the rink?
Scott?
No.
Not Scott Ellis?
No, Scott was a regular cast member.
Oh, yeah.
Bob Marshall.
Bob Marshall?
Yes.
Hi. That's
right. Because when you can't get me, you go for Rob Marshall.
Yeah. Broke my finger in the show when he was, because he was the understudy. And so he broke my finger, and I told him, should you ever become a huge star, which he is now as a choreographer and director, I said, I'm telling everybody from the stage that you broke my finger. Never let your head get so big that, you know, the world.
You're so right.
And
so
I do that. I do that.
Hey, Cheetah.
Cheetah, am I crazy, or were you, when all this happened, weren't you just recently still out on the road doing your show?
Well, I was under the weather. Lisa and I both had coughs, and through the whole winter, we were just feeling kind of low, but everything was fine. And I know, we went away, and then we came back, and then Rosie and I went to Dallas, and we came back, and then I didn't feel too well, you know. But I've had all the exams, and everything's fine. But it's the weirdest thing. The wonderful thing about, if this can have anything positive come from it at all, is that it brings us all together. For me to sit here and see you, and James and Seth, and people that I'm blessed to have had so much love from and are in my life and make me who I am. We have time. We have time now to really cherish that and tell each other. We've got to tell each other.
Yeah.
And help each other. But we know we love each other. So
no, you are my favorite person in the world, and you have been from the day I met you.
Hey, you know you don't mean that.
I do. You just, when it is my favorite story to tell is about
tell it
journey. Well, I'll try and condense it because I don't want to embarrass you. But when Liza would miss a show, there was the audience could have a refund that night if they so chose. And on one night, I don't know what we would have had to start with, but the number that stayed was very low. And I think the stage managers came to you and said, Cheetah, I don't know, do you want to, there's maybe 100 people. Do you want to do this? You want to bag it? The first thing this woman said was, there were six guys in the show. She said, if we don't do the show, will the boys be docked a part of their salary? And the stage manager said, yes. She said, well, call the boys down here. Let's talk. So all six of us went to your room.
Yeah.
And you said, well, you know, guys, here's the story. There's not many people out there, but we have a new understudy for Liza. She hasn't really had a big rehearsal. We could treat it like a big rehearsal. We'll go out. We'll have a good time. We'll have a blast, and we'll just be silly and have fun. And that way nobody will have to suffer or lose any salary. And we were all going, okay, let's do that. And we could probably see we had mischief in our eyes. And before we left your room, you said, and this is what elevated you to goddess in my mind. You said, boys, the people that stayed. Give them our show.
I went,
who is this woman? Who is this woman?
Jason, they make us the Kentucky ticket person.
Yeah.
You know, all of those people, we wouldn't be where we are. We wouldn't be able to express ourselves and make people feel as good and as smart as they can if we didn't have, you know, that care and that love and that respect for those people out there that are from here to California, all over the world. And so we're just lucky.
But you are, the fact, Cheetah, that your first thought in that situation was first of your colleagues and then of your audience, that's the thing that stayed with me. And that's the thing that I went, if I'm ever lucky enough to have, you know, a career of note, I want to be able to hold those values in my heart. You really planted them there, and I have clung to them, and I have remembered you and held you in my heart because of it ever since. You have no idea the impact you made on me as someone trying to be a professional in our business who has been blessed with some success. You have always been, from the time I was 24 years old, my role model.
Oh, Jay, I'm going to cry.
Okay, and
can you guys see, where's the table? Can you guys see that picture behind me?
I see a big something, but not the table.
Darn it.
You have to just angle the iPad.
A picture back there of Lisa and me, and Lisa's dad, Tony Mordenti, directed West Side Story, and I saw it in, where was it? The Burt Reynolds Theater.
In Florida.
And it's the two of us with a cast standing around, just holding their hearts, holding their breath, being so happy for us. And Lisa, I'll never forget that.
Lisa played Anita.
I'm crazy. And Lisa played the part that's Anita. My tummy.
Oh my gosh.
So she was in your tummy during West Side Story. Then she played Anita when she grew up.
Yeah.
I want to say, so first of all, Cheetah, we have to bring you back for a whole show. We gave you a fake name, so Jason wouldn't know. That's why it says Dolores, because your real name is Dolores Conchita del Rivero. That I know. And please tell Jason, by the way, tell Jason before we go, tell Jason when you decided not to be ethnic back in the 50s, the name you came up with when you did that show off Broadway.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know everything about me anyhow. my real name is Dolores Conchita Figueroa del Rivero. Okay? And repeat after me. Okay. And then, so I decided I love Maureen O'Hara. I just love her. And I know I've got to change my name. And so what'll I change it to? Oh, I know. Cheetah O'Hara. That's it. Cheetah O'Hara. And so my phone would ring and everybody on the other end would say, Cheetah who? And hang up. Those are the kind of friends I have.
Idiot!
But I loved, I was like, for 6 days, I was Cheetah O'Hara. I could beat the hell out of John Wayne. Absolutely beat the hell out of John Wayne.
And out sing the crap out of Kelly O'Hara.
Yeah!
All right, we're going to bring you and Lisa back for a full show, okay? So peace out. Cheetah, you're going to come back. Lisa, you're going to come back. We love you. Thank you for being here.
Love you, baby.
I'm so happy you're in my life.
Oh, okay. Thank you,
so sweet.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Rosie. Bye, Lisa. Bye, Cheet. Surprise, Jason.
Oh, my God. You've made my year. She is – I'm not kidding. When I swoon over her. She really meant so much to me during that time. And that show remains, you know, I've had a really fortunate career. That group, Liza, Stockard, Cheetah, wow, the guys, that was the most fun I've ever had on a Broadway stage. We played like little devils, and those ladies were so much fun and so glorious to be with and made us such a part of their, I mean, it's their show, it's their vehicle, and they made us so much a part of their lives. That it was just, I could go on and on.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Jason Alexander, before you sing your first song.
Yeah.
Now, by the way, I have a new podcast all about high school, and I had Jason on my podcast. It's going to launch tomorrow. But Jason talked about, I don't know if it was your first Broadway show, but it was a Broadway show that had a big impact on you. Yes. So just talk about that for a minute, and then I want to hear you do a song.
So I had just moved from Maplewood, New Jersey to Livingston, New Jersey in 1972.
Lateral move.
Sorry. Yeah, lateral move at best. And the first kids that I'd never been on stage, the first kids that picked me up when I moved, I didn't know anybody, were the theater kids. They were doing a production of Sound of Music, and they had lost their Friedrich von Trapp. And this girl saw me standing in the community pool and said, "Do you sing?" And I went, I do now. And I did Sound of Music, fell in with those kids, loved the community of theater. Still wasn't thinking, I'm an actor, but excuse me, loved hanging with those kids. And because we were so close to New York, we would go every weekend on the bus and we'd see a matinee and an evening show. And about 10 shows in, 10 weekends in, I go to see an early preview of Pippin. And my head explodes because I wanted to be a magician. First thing that happens in the show is this gorgeous African-American man comes out with fingers the size of my entire body and goes, "Join us." And I went, "Oh my God." And there's magic and that music and that Fosse dance and that whole world of theater just hit me. And I went, "Oh my God, this is an illusion. This whole thing is this box that I'm looking into. That's a magic trick. I want to do that trick." And so because of that show, I started really being serious about wanting to be an actor, started taking voice and dance lessons, and then saw Pippin, the Broadway production, probably 21 times, I think.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Yeah. Amazing. You know, Betty Buckley watches this. So, hi, Betty Buckley. You were Catherine.
Hi, Betty Buckley.
She's getting a guest appearance tomorrow on our Andrew Lloyd Webber show. All right. So what are you going to give us? Are you going to some tea for the...
I'm gonna try. So we do this number in my concert show, in my symphony show, and we have a track for it, but let me see if it'll work. So we'll recognize it, and we do it up a little bit, and it goes something like this. Everything has a season. Everything has a time. Show me a reason and I'll show you a rhyme. Cats fit on a windowsill. Children fit in the snow. Why do I feel I don't fit in anywhere I go? Rivers belong where they can ramble. Eagles belong where they can fly. I've got to be where my spirit can run free. I've got to find my corner of the sky. Every man has a daydream. Every man has a goal. People like the way dreams have of sticking to the soul. Thunderclouds have lightning. Nightingales have their song. Don't you see? I want my life to be something more than long. Original choreography. Rivers belong where they can ramble. Eagles belong where they can fly. I've got to be where my spirit can run free. I've got to find my corner of the sky. So maybe some misty morning you will awaken and find me gone. And far away I will be singing to the dawn. And you may wonder, am I happy there? A little more than I've been. And the answer will come back to you like laughter on the wind. So rivers belong where they can ramble. Eagles belong where they can fly. And I've got to be where my spirit can run free. I gotta find a corner. I've got to find my corner. There has to be a corner. Everyone has a corner. And I'm gonna find my corner of the sky.
Yes, on the vibrato on the last note.
Thank you, Fisherman's Friend. I'd like to thank the good people, the Fisherman's Friend.
Well, I was just thinking, by the way, you know, John Cantor and Fred Ever known for vamps, but Pippin has amazing. It has this. But But on your song, it has that amazing. Yeah. Anyway, what do you want to say, James?
Yeah, I was going to say,
look at this.
These comments that came in today would have been our closing of Pippin if we didn't get posted.
And then one more. Yeah, so nice that you did that for them.
Yeah.
A little tip of the hat.
So, and that is to show that, boy, it's never not being done. There's not a minute of the day.
Great show. Every song.
Yep.
Donations.
We got some donations, and these are a few donations that have come in so far. Glorianne from New Jersey, $25. Thank you.
Hey, that's great.
Jennifer from Massachusetts, $50. Jennifer from Wisconsin, $40. Matthew from New York, $92. Stephen from New York, $257.
Wow.
Kevin from Massachusetts, $50. Trent from New York, $50. Jim from New Jersey, $103. John from Tennessee, $175.
Tennessee.
There you go. Nancy from Massachusetts, $50. James from New York, $25. Dennis from California, $101. Scott from New York, $257. Mary from Massachusetts, $51. And another Tennessee, Seth.
Philippa from Tennessee, $40. Thank you, guys.
Wow. And not one of our people, Seth, because it would have been in multiples of chai. You just know.
I keep looking for a 36. 100%.
Where are they?
I don't know. They're all in shul.
Okay.
So we're going to bring up the good doctor, Dr. John LaPook. Jason, if you have any questions, or we can ask questions and comments. So here we go. Okay. For a chief medical correspondent.
Hi, Doc. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. So what you got? What can I do for you?
Jason, do you have anything? If not, yeah. We have questions. Jason, do you have any question for Dr. John LaPook?
No, you know, Doc, here's the question. So my wife, who leaves no stone unturned, and I just want to know, is this smart or is this kind of madness? So when you bring the mail in from the mail, is it, I know people say it can live on cardboard, live on paper. I mean, are people taking the wipes and wiping down the mail and the newspaper? And
can I just say, you know, we don't know the answer to it. James actually had a really good thought, which was, so what you're referring to is there was a recent study where they found that the virus could survive or be measured on cardboard,
right.
I guess like paper, in a day later or so, and then harder surfaces like plastic and metal a few days later. So could, if the mailman had the virus on their hands, could it be on the envelope? You can go, I can't say that there's an answer to this. I haven't seen anything that you could transmit this by the mail. That has not been out there.
Right.
But we're all figuring this out. You know, what do you do? So you take the mail in, you open it up, you throw out the envelope, but then how do you get the letter? If, you know, so you can start to go down a rabbit hole. But James said, if it lasts a day, maybe you just leave the mail for 2 days.
Sure.
And then open it. But let me tell you something about this business about the virus being on surfaces. What's not known is how infectious it is. So right. You can be able to scientifically measure it, but what does that really mean? Just like the aerosolization, they literally spray it in the air and then they can measure it a few hours later. But is that what happens when somebody sneezes? There are a lot of questions here. I know that's like a very practical thing that people want to know what to do. I think if you basically open up the mail, whenever you decide to do it, and then really after you open it up and you're reading it, wash your hands. We can't say that enough, because the envelope that the virus is surrounded by, it's a lipid fatty envelope, and it's dissolved, destroyed by soap. So that's why people asked about, you know, laundry. If you have a laundry and you put soap in and it's hot water, it's going to be hard for that thing to survive.
Question from somebody that's asking a comment. Can you give a detailed definition of social distancing? Everyone seems to have a different version of what that actually means. What up?
Okay, so what everybody seems to agree with, and I again send you to cdc.gov, because now they're getting really granular and understanding people have these questions. Close contact is within 6 feet. Why 6 feet? It's because if you sneeze or cough, maybe that's about how far a droplet could go, right? The question that's being debated is, well, how long within 6 feet? And I've spoken to a bunch of people. Pretty much the consensus is, if you're walking by somebody in the park and boom, you're by them, and yes, you're within 2.5 feet, that's not a high risk exposure. If you're in an edit room with them for an hour and you're right together, that's a high risk exposure if you're close by. Whether it's within 5 minutes together or how many minutes, you know, we don't know that, but pretty much people are understanding that if it's greater than 6 feet, then it's really hard to get that close exposure. And the asterisk being, we're hoping that aerosolization, where it hangs in the air, is not really a big factor here. We're hoping that that's true, and that remains to be seen. So
that's a good clarification on that. So I know it's in any water droplets that come from the throat or the nose. Anything about sweat or just evaporation from the skin or anything like that?
I haven't seen anything about it being in sweat. It's mostly, it's a respiratory illness. How would it get it? I don't think it would be in sweat. I'll look it up afterwards to see if they're just to make sure, but I don't think that's a risk. But again, if you're not within 6 feet, you're not going to get the sweat from in the lungs, right? So, you know, there are these receptors in the lung. They're called ACE2 receptors. You don't need to know that. However, there will be a test on it. And what happens is the virus goes in, it goes to the back of your throat and your nose. That's why they do the swab there. And then it starts to work its way down. So as you might get a little sore throat, you may get the sniffles. As it works its way down your breathing tube, you can start to get the cough, right? As it gets all the way out into your lungs, you can actually get pneumonia. So some people have asked me, well, I'm feeling a little anxious. I think I'm short, you know, maybe am I short of breath? I don't know, because you become conscious of an unconscious thing and suddenly you may be short of breath. If you don't have a cough, it's hard to know how that happens from pneumonia. You're probably not short of breath from pneumonia, because you should get cough, fever, and then the pneumonia, and then the shortness of breath comes because the pneumonia is so involved in your lungs that you can't transfer oxygen from the outside to the inside of your body through these little air sacs called alveoli. So if those are getting all smushed up full of schmutz, then the oxygen can't get transferred into your bloodstream and you'll feel short of breath.
Is schmutz a medical word? Okay,
it actually is. From the first day of medical school, Dr. Michael Gershon, who was my histology teacher, who was so great, he used that word. And it's exactly what I turned to the guy next to me and said, it could have been a gal too. Was that, what, schmutz, what is that? I'd never heard of that. And we all were laughing, but it actually is a word. I think it's German, and it's like schmutz. It means, you can't use a word to define it, if it's like stuff, little droplets.
I know what schmutz means. I'm Jewish. Don't define it for me. What the hell?
Look at Jason.
Wait, Jewish? Oh my God.
Speaking of Jews, I bring on Blake Ross. Hi, Blake.
Hi.
So Blake, you know, you founded this thing that really Dr. LaPook has been talking about staying connected as we're socially distant. You founded this website. By the way, your lighting is crazy, but I'm going to go with it right now.
Whoa,
but
it's sorry.
Not since I was clubbing in the 80s. Anyway, you found a website.
When my kid is sleeping. Basically, I start, you know, as Dr. LaPook has been talking about all week, and thank you, Dr. LaPook. I cannot wait to see the Broadway show that you're going to star in after all of this. it's called akindstranger.com. All of a sudden, our social connection just disappeared out of nowhere. And especially for theater folks like us, we're used to congregating together and sharing art together and having a shared experience. And that was just taken away from us in the blink of an eye. And so a lot of people have been wondering, how in the world can they have connections with strangers or with anybody in this coronavirus world? And so I started a service that connects people who want to help with people who need help. You can donate as little as 30 minutes of your time virtually to connect with a stranger. You could be just simply a connection on the other end, a friendly face to say hello. If you have any expertise that you're willing to share, some people have, you know, need help redoing their resumes. They need help filing for unemployment. They've never had to do any of this stuff before. They need to help teaching their kids at home. We have tons of teachers in our network. We had 100 people sign up in the last 24 hours to try and give of their time to people in need. So please, you're not alone. People want to connect in this time. So please sign up. Again, it's akindstranger.com. And Seth and James, thank you what you're doing for the Actors Fund. It's so necessary. And we just want to help in this time.
I love
it's
that idea.
It's time to talk about talking to kids, especially with you. I'm sure you're thinking about that. I called Harold Koplowitz, who's the head of Child Mind Institute. That's a very good resource, Child Mind Institute. And actually, I'm looking right at their website right here. Of course, it went on screensave. But I'll just tell you that one of the things that he says is so important when you're talking to kids is to be reassuring, to have a schedule for them, because a lot of their schedule has been thrown off, to model, you know, to try to control your own anxiety, because it's, you know,
that's, we're all visual.
And the visual. And one of the things that's so important that he emphasized to me was, and this was actually from, you know, sadly from one of the shootings that happened, you know, in the past, is listen to them. You know, it's a very, it's a real instinct to want to just do a brain dump and talk to them, but listen to them, find out what their questions are, and remember to be age appropriate. So what a 4-year-old is thinking is different than what a 6-year-old is thinking, than what a 10 and 13-year-old. So ask them what questions they have. Don't necessarily give, don't give them more information than they're asking, but be honest with them, because, you know, kids will pick up on everything, on every vibe. And again, I always use this as an example, which is when you're in an airplane and it's a bumpy ride, where do you look? You look at the flight attendant, right? If the flight attendant's nervous, then you're nervous.
Totally.
So you're the flight attendant. We're the flight attendants for those kids. So try to model good executive thinking, good decision-making, be relaxed as you can with them, and give them a schedule throughout the day. That's, it's really, although their schedule is disrupted. I had a colleague who was so cute that even though the kids were doing homeschooling, every morning they put on their backpacks, they prepared as though they were going to take the school bus. They got all, and then they were home, but they just loved that part of the day. So,
well, a lot of moms like myself, we don't really know, we've never been home teachers before. And so we don't really know where to go or how to craft a day around staying home when we've been working parents or even stay at home parents. We're not used to having to teach our kids. So I've connected with a lot of moms through A Kind Stranger who are sharing different resources. There's lots of teachers that are sharing their syllabuses to try and help just get people moving. And, you know, don't try and do it all. We don't want to, you know, reinvent the wheel. We just want to try and get our kids through this. Like you said, keep it light, keep it going, let our families connect during this time, and also just try and connect with each other as much as we can and know that we're not alone during this time.
One last thing before I came up again. If you Google, if you search for Child Mind Institute space coronavirus, I'm looking at talking to kids about coronavirus. It's really good. Don't be afraid to discuss it. Be developmentally appropriate. Take the cues from your child. Deal with your own anxiety. Be reassuring. Focus on what you're doing to stay safe. Stick to routine and keep talking. It's really good. And there's a video, and that this is Hal Koplowitz's organization, and it's very good. I've dealt with them before.
We'll share it with our moms in the network. Yeah. Thanks, Dr. LaPook, as always.
Thank you, Blake. You'll be back again. A Kind Stranger. Oh, I'm getting a rainbow. I never get this. Hold on. Rainbow. Well, I guess I'll just wait it out. All right. Oh, there we go.
There we go. Okay, so, all right, bye, Blake.
Bye,
we'll
Blake.
See you.
Peace out.
Nice meeting you.
Dr. LaPook, we will see you at the very end of the show to say goodbye.
Bye.
Mr. Jason Alexander, today's Sondheim's birthday. We got to talk for a second. How did you get Merrily Re-Roll Along? What were you, 21 years old?
20 when I got it. I think I told everyone during it. It was a straight equity open audition call. I went in and at 20, I had a little bald spot. So I was exactly what they were looking for, a kid that could play an older guy. But I went in, I sang 2 songs. You know, it was the most intimidating table. Hal Prince, Steve Sondheim, Paul Gemignani, Ron Field, George Firth. I mean, Joanna Merlin was the only one I went, she looks kind. And, and did my thing and walked out. And I remember Paul Gemignani came out and met me at the water fountain. I went, really good, kid, really good. And I was then asked to do a reading for them, and I think that was pretty much, I didn't know at the time, but I think they had their eye on me from that time.
You were so good at that show, and I didn't get to see it. By the way, how long did it actually run?
If I'm remembering correctly, we previewed for 11 weeks and opened and then ran another 2. So 13 weeks total, but only 2 post-opener.
I was obsessed with you on the album, and I actually found a little clip. I'm obsessed with your staging, your confidence. Now, I can only show 30-second clips, so it's going to be in a row. But just so people don't know, Lonnie Price is auditioning with Jim Walton. They're a songwriting team, and they're auditioning for this producer played by a 21-year-old, Jason Alexander. But I'm obsessed with your voice. I'm obsessed with your little dance steps. Who came up with those little dance steps?
I think the one in this, if you're doing Opening Doors, I think it's me. I don't think it was Ron Field, but it might be. I don't want to not credit him. I think it was.
And you get like huge laughs. Let's watch a little bit of you. Here we go. That's well, that's well. Watching that again,
it's surreal. I mean, Lonnie did this to me when he was making the documentary and he had clips like that, and I just went, it feels like it's just another person, another life. But I remember that song. My wife, we weren't even engaged yet, we had just started dating when rehearsals for Merrily started, and she was allowed to come over to a rehearsal where we were rehearsing that song. And we got to that, and I went, there's not, then you go, bum, 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 da, da. And she went, oh, he doesn't suck, because she had never seen me act. She an actor, and, you know.
100%. Okay, so I'm going to flash forward to, I think, the first show that I saw you in. First show I saw you in was Jerome Robbins Broadway, where you were a fiddler. You were basically everybody who hosted it. You told me a crazy story about having a stun gun or something during your pocket. My point is, who do you remember when you told me that crazy story? Who do you think you were hanging out with on that corner when you told me that crazy story?
If I remember correctly, we were either it was a nightly walk to a bus, or we might have been going to a party. For some reason, the incident, I think it was Charlotte D'Amboise who may have backed into a guy who was coming out of a store.
Hold on. Let me just quickly, I'll quickly ask her. Hey, Charlotte.
Hi, baby.
Hi. All my favorite people. Hi.
Oh, and you know what? I think you may have also been hanging out with them.
Saying, Jason.
Oh, stop it. I mean, finish your thought. But
yeah. Let me ask Jason. I think it was actually Charlotte and maybe Joanne Hunter?
Hey, JoJo. Do you remember this?
Oh my God, Jason, I was just watching that clip of you on Merrily, and I was like, oh my God, he moves exactly the way I remember him.
Yeah.
Oh, you're little.
You're on this level. I remember it too.
So tell everybody, so Jason started Jerome Robbins Broadway. Charlotte was Anita and Peter Pan. Joanne, were you assisting Jerome Robbins? Where were you in it?
No, I was tucked in, but then I took over as the angel. And I was the matinee Maria.
And Don't forget Fiddler.
Well, right. You know what? I was originally, who's the one who gets married?
Oh, it's Vital.
I was Vital. This is a really, I can't say this on, because this was a, it'll make Jerry Robbins sound bad. It was a racial incident is why I was taken out of the role.
Oh,
Jewish enough, Joanne? I mean,
what are you doing?
I was not available. So Jason, please tell your story about the stun gun. Go. I'm getting out of here. Go.
Well, honestly, I had a stalker from years ago, and I had gotten a really strange, I don't think you guys even know this, but I had gotten a really kind of quasi-threatening opening night telegram for JRB. And so it really kind of freaked me out. And I found it couldn't be online because we didn't have online, but I must have found in a catalog, because I was studying martial arts, so it must have been a martial art catalog, these little pocket stun guns that you could carry. Who knew if they would work? Who knew? But I had one in my bag. And when this thing happened, my memory is this kid got really aggressive really fast, and we tried to defuse it, and he was not letting it go. And I summoned my best Chuck Norris. I had my hand on it in my shoulder bag, and I went, okay, if we're going to do this, you need to come about 3 feet closer because I don't want to miss. Now, if someone said that to me, I'd go, all respect, I back down. He charged at me, and I didn't know if this thing would even work. How do you test it? You don't put it against yourself. But he came at me, and I remember, I think I got him on the neck, and he went, and I just remember we ran. That's my memory of it. But
Charlotte?
was it more or less exciting than that, Char?
It was so exciting. I'm so confused by who I'm looking at and what the hell is going on.
Okay, you're a fire
truck. You're a mess, Charlotte.
I'm on my phone, so I can't even see. But right, anyway.
You'll get 20 people on a screen that big.
You know, everybody's this big. I think
Faith Prince will back me up because I think Faith might have been in that group, I think.
Well, I'm gonna ask Joanne Hunter, whenever we bring on surprise guests, we always make them tell a story about our celebrity that maybe no one else remembers or nobody else knows. You have a little story about Jason Alexander you'd like to share, Joanne?
You know what, Jason, that story that you were just telling, I don't really remember that, to be honest with you, but so maybe I wasn't there. But you know what I remember? I think you taught us a self-defense class.
Yeah.
That's what I remember. Jason Alexander taught us self-defense, and I remember you taught me how to use this part of my hand to, if someone came up to me, do that. You
soft taught me the hard, right? Hard
and strong. Then you also said to pop their eardrums.
Where's the camera?
Yep. Boom. This is Jason Alexander, and I, to this day, I remember those things. Or the first thing you said was call attention to yourself.
Yeah.
And scream as loud as you can and run around a car.
Yeah. Make a fool of yourself. Make a scene. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. To this day, I remember that. And it was you who taught me that.
You're a good little pupil, the sensei said.
Uh-huh. All right. Joanne, you're going to come back. Charlotte, you're going to come back. Charlotte, work on your technical skills. Not to emphasize, but you're okay. Fine. Remove from the screen. Joanne Hunter, we're going to see you again.
Jason Alexander.
Oh, Joe.
So, and I just have to say one thing. I was listening to your, sorry, Seth, one thing. I was just listening to your little, when you were talking to Cheetah Rivera.
Yeah.
And how she influenced you so. And I have to just say this. I go, well, you know what? It came full circle because you were an amazing leader in that company. Right. And always gracious, always kind, treated everybody equally. And I thought to myself, well, you were a great student because you did the same. And you should know that. So I just wanted you to.
Thanks, love.
Oh, hey, you
look gorgeous as ever.
Stop it.
Joanne, we love you. We'll talk soon. I'm going to call you later.
Okay, bye.
All right, Jason Alexander.
Let's go ahead.
I know. How nice you got to see this. You got to connect during this time, man.
Oh, my God. These are such great surprises. They're amazing.
Well, Jason, if you come back, we're going to be here. We'll have more surprises for you. So you have to come back another time.
All right. Let's do it.
Okay, so we want you to do a song for Merrily We Roll Along that you literally happen to have a track for. I'm so excited.
I have a track for it. It's a very Sinatra-esque version of it. Now, so in the symphony show, we built a great Merrily medley. I'm not going to do the whole medley because I don't have a track for it, but it would do a Good Thing Going to Now You Know to Not a Day Goes By.
And
it tells a whole story. But when we were first putting it together, my musical director, Todd Schroeder, do you know Todd?
No, I don't, but I know Schroeder.
Oh, yeah, I mean, you would love each other. This is a track that Todd put together, so let me give it a shot. Very Sinatra-esque. Here we go. Mm-hmm. It started out like a song. We started quiet and slow with no surprise. Then one morning I woke to realize we had a good thing going. It's not that nothing went wrong. Some angry moments, of course, but just a few. Only moments, no more, because we knew we had this good thing going. And if I wanted too much, Was that such a mistake? At the time, you never wanted enough. All right, tough, I don't make that a crime. While it's going along, you take for granted some love will wear away. You took for granted a lot, but still I say we could have kept on growing instead of just kept on. We had a good thing going, 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 going. We had a good thing going, going. Come. Happy birthday, Mr. Sondheim.
First of all, so amazing. And you were belting an A.
Going. The A is still there. Stephen Schwartz, when we were recording A Guy Like You for the Hunchback thing, he had me singing a high B, which we did three times. Three times we did the high B. And then I said, I don't have a high B anymore, Stephen. So I sang a great A, and he made it the best high B with auto-tune that you've ever heard in your life.
Not since Phantom of the Opera. Okay, Jason, stay there. We're going to bring you back. We're going to bring on our company opening night, so don't go nowhere.
Okay,
so here we go. So today is Sondheim's birthday. It was supposed to coincide with the opening of company. It's not happening. It's being postponed. But we have some of the cast here in their opening night finery celebrating their opening night. So first, we have the wonderful Mr. Christopher Sieber.
Hi, Chris.
Look at this.
Huh? Is very handsome.
Is that what you're going to wear for opening?
It's Ted Baker, all Ted Baker, except for the Thomas Pink pocket square that cost an exorbitant amount of money for some reason.
Yes, very classy. And then we have quite the opposite, Christopher Fitzgerald.
Hi.
Hey!
I have
you look good!
My stepfather's Joseph A. Bank coat. And I'm going with a short pant this year. I just thought I might, you know, I'm known for my calves. I've done a special with Seth about them. And so
calves are amazing.
I thought I'd, highlight that, you know.
Also, you're in full a lace front. Your hair looks amazing.
Yeah, I'm just doing a new thing. I'm trying to grow as much hair as possible. I have no other hair on the rest of my body.
I know, but it's a weave, and it works.
But I have a weave. Yeah, I'm working on a weave. I'm going to see how curly I can get it, and see how like dense I can get it.
Chris, where are you?
I'm in North Carolina, actually.
Are you?
Yeah.
The whole family.
I'm here with my family. Yes, hanging out with my folks for a little while.
We love your mom. You got to come back. We got to get that ghost story, and we got to get that rat bat story. I'm just telling you right now, you're coming back for that.
You will get all the stories. We're going to have plenty of time.
And our third member here.
Let's bring her in.
She is fully glamorous. Yes, Miss Tony nominee, Jennifer Simard.
Hello.
Whoa.
Jennifer. You look
Look at her.
Hey, you guys look so handsome. I miss all four of you so much.
Aw. You look lovely.
We want to see everything.
See the makeup.
Oh, okay. I have another outfit for opening. It was between this and another thing. And I think I'll wear the other one when we open because we're going to this. But to this, I actually feel like I could audition for a chorus line in this. You know what I mean? It's kind of right? Right?
You still got it.
Thank you.
So you're married to Chris in the show.
Christopher. Well, they're both Christopher. Mr. Sieber and I. You look so handsome. Yes.
That guy.
But Fitz and I, we have kind of a dance moment at the top of Act 2. I like to think we're partners in side by side a bit.
Hold on. So
before we go on, I want you to read the donations. Do our surprise guest with everyone.
Oh, look at this comment, Seth. Look at this right here from Brett. living in a tiny town in Arkansas, I never get to see stuff like this. So thank you, Seth. Oh, that's so nice, Brett.
You're at an opening night.
Yeah, you're at an opening night of a Broadway show.
Sorry. Yeah, you're at an opening. You are here. You made it.
Yeah, and Arkansas is right near you. You're in North Carolina. It's like right down the block.
So. Okay. So these are some of the donations that have come in while all the three of you have been glamming up. Stephanie from New York gave to the actorsfund.org. It's never too late to give. Stephanie from New York, $25. Barbara from Oregon has been watching, donated $25. Rebecca from Florida, $50. Gail from Massachusetts, $50. Rachel from New York, $100. Also from New York, Megan, $100. Wow. Marissa from New York, $50. Mira from New York, $36. Bruce from Washington, D.C., $77. And Jackie from Connecticut, $36.
Yay! What we do together can make a difference.
So, and we want to just reiterate, Actors Fund for everybody in the business, not just, you know, by the way, Jennifer, your husband is not an actor and he's in the business. What does your husband do?
My husband is a stagehand and he works for the Schubert Organization. He's the house electrician at the Belasco Theater. And so that to your point. And it's also for one of my favorite parts of the Actors Fund, if I may, is the Lillian Booth Actors Home in New Jersey. And it's a place where we can take care of the people that took such good care of us. Because at that point in your life, I believe everyone is entitled to three things: joy, comfort, and dignity. And it's so important. And that section of New Jersey is hit so hard by COVID-19. So, and I'd also like to say, I love all the small amounts that you just listed off, because I really believe if you, I don't know if you're like me, I think, oh, I don't have a lot of money. Maybe $1. If everyone on my Instagram page, you know, donated, we have $3. No, we have $11,000 or something. You know, that's,
but you know,
$1. You can make a difference. Just
want to say, I want to say about that nursing home where the money for the Actors Fund goes to. You know, the nurses have to be there to help everybody in that, you know, aging community. Yeah, well, kids are no longer in school, so the Actors Fund is actually paying for childcare, so all the nurses can be at the Actors Fund home. So there's so much money that has to go out. We got to bring it in.
Yeah.
So here comes our special surprise guest.
It's actually a surprise for Jason and the three of you,
because you're all Sondheim fans. And you're in company.
Okay.
We would bring someone from Sondheim's company, the original Marta. It's Pamela Myers.
Oh, now.
Oh, Pam.
There she is.
How are you?
I saw you guys. You were terrific. You really made me laugh. I am not kidding. Really made me laugh.
Thank you so much.
I haven't seen you for ages.
I know. Here I am in Cincinnati.
And boy, you warmed up.
I did Into the Woods, the revival of Into the Woods together.
Oh,
I know.
You were the prince and you were the mom.
I was the stepmom. That's right. Yeah.
Oh, okay, I want to talk to Pam for a minute. I'm going to bring you guys back. Hi, Jennifer. Okay. The history. So you were the original Marta in company.
Uh-huh.
And
I'm Marta's grandma, I think.
So good, though.
I have something to show you. These are the original shoes I had to wear. Can you see these?
I'm loving this. Yes!
They only lasted through a few previews. They're long, silver. They look, though, like leg braces.
You mean they
wrap
up?
They were very hard to work with.
Did they wrap up your leg?
What?
They wrapped up your leg?
Yes! Like gladiator sandals. As you can see. Anyway, they gave them to me at the end of the run. Hilarious. And this scarf right here, Dee Dee Ryan, who was the costume designer, you know, during previews, she literally took this off of her own neck backstage and put it around my neck and said, okay, you wear this tonight. And I did. And that didn't last either. Goodbye. I mean, that was gone. Like two shows later, and everything went except the vest in my costume.
So. I'm loving doing these shows in people's houses because they're bringing things like we've never seen before.
Isn't it?
I mean, if you don't know, we said before, Joanna Gleason is literally auctioning off the original staff from Into the Woods. I mean,
oh, that's fabulous!
Isn't that incredible? So if
So
I want to talk about Sondheim for a second. It's not like you came into the show during the readings and the workshops. You got cast in the show as Marta. And then after you were cast, he said, your voice is so bright. Why don't I write something? Like, how did the song happen?
No. I'll tell you how it happened. I auditioned. There wasn't the part of Marta yet. And they had me read, actually, for Beth's part.
Somebody else's.
It was cold reading. And I sang Shy and Little Green Apples. And Hal was there, and he said, Steve, is there something, some way we can use this girl? And we were in the theater then, you know, on the stage with the work light. He was out in the house, and George Firth and Ruthie Mitchell and Steve.
Steven, by the way.
I was 22.
Wow.
And anyway, I had a call back, and we had a potential cast read through, and it was in the lobby of one of the theaters, and not all the same people were there that were in the cast. Oh. So, but I was, and after the read through, Stephen came up to me and said, I wrote you a song. Wow. And I said, well, I guess I got it. And that was literally what I remember about it.
So you didn't even know till the song was written. And then when he sang it to you, you were like, I'm not going to remember all these damn lyrics. Did you have a breakdown?
First of all, I have the music actually over my piano. Aww. It's the original music, and it's like a minor fourth higher.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. The starting note was an F sharp.
Ow.
Yes. And so we sang through it once in that key, and everybody said at the same time, I think this is too high. I was in my head voice. And anyway, he, boom, changed the key, over and out. That was it. Now, it didn't have an ending. He had like a fade out ending where I would just keep singing it. And finally, they found the ending to it. And then they found the ending to the show after I don't know how many endings.
All right,
that all happened out of town.
Okay, so as a little present for the company cast,
yes,
we'd love a little Marta recreation, not since 1970s when you originated this. I mean, this is literally a classic. What does it feel like to know that you originated a classic song on Broadway?
Well, it is startling because it has become, you know, a cult. Company is a cult.
In a good way.
I was sitting in that audience last week. I can tell you right now that was like the same reception we would have at every show too. I mean, it just, people are just crazed by company. No matter who plays the parts, men, women, you know, it's just, it's so fabulous. They just change the keys, I guess.
Exactly. And you're passing the torch. Okay, we're gonna have a little recreation of a little 1970s
action. Okay, now listen, I gotta find this now. I lost it.
Oh yeah, you want me to send it?
It's on my It's on my email, right?
Yeah, or you can just go to history, like if you're on Safari or something. Uh-oh.
Well, let's see. I'll try it.
Good luck.
No, that's not it. Okay, I don't know. It just went away. I don't know what that is. Here I am in Cincinnati.
I know.
With my cat.
Christopher Sieber's loving it.
Hey, Chris.
Wait a minute. This isn't it. Where is it? Oh, my gosh.
Oh, that's nice.
I think it got messed up or something. Well.
Do you want me to send it to you? We're going to have it somewhere.
Wait a minute.
Hold on.
What's this? No, that's not it.
It's not. Don't call up porn because that's embarrassing.
That would be awesome.
Well, that's it was just here a minute ago.
Okay, I'll talk to these. So, Pam, I'm talking to these clowns.
Just play it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Who, me?
To talk.
I'm going to talk to these clowns. So, Pam, wave to me when you find it. I can see you on the screen. I'll talk to these four clowns. Okay, hold on. Let me get rid of this.
You're going to talk to me too? Talk to them.
Talk to these clowns. Okay, so
clowns.
Let me ask you, Jennifer and Chris, by the way, when I don't know if you guys know, but the role of Harry was played by Seth Rudetsky and Hewlett High School in 1982.
Do you have it? Do you have it? Of course you do.
No, but I did nail it.
You don't have a video?
Actually, you know what? There is a video somewhere. I should find it. But I have to say, I sang Sorry Grateful. I literally didn't understand the lyrics for like a year ago. I was just I was just like, la, 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 la. I mean, I had no idea what that song was about. So do you sing it now, Chris? Jennifer?
I do. So does Fitz as well. And you know what? When I heard the song, you know, I've heard it, you know, pretty much my entire life because the show is as old as I am. But I always thought it was kind of a funny song. And when you hear it on the cast recording, listen to me. When you hear it on the cast recording, it sounds so like dirgy to me. Well, it comes across as a different way. When you think about it, it's like trying to explain marriage, which is an inconceivable concept to a 2-year-old. That makes me laugh because you're trying to explain something that's unexplainable to somebody. But there's so many depth. There's so many things in the song that anyone in a long-term relationship or marriage will go like, oh yeah, that's what it is. That's what it is. But to explain it to somebody who doesn't understand, it's impossible.
And Chris, what's your take on it? A hilarious comedy song?
Let's put it this way. It wasn't my kids' favorite song when they saw the dress rehearsal.
Wait, 100%. I was always like, okay, Jennifer Simard,
yes.
In the crazy karate scene, did you like take karate lessons or like jujitsu, whatever?
Yeah, it's been changed to jujitsu for this production. And we did. We went to Victor Shilin's Brazilian jujitsu on 8th Avenue and 47th Street. They took really good care of us. And
I still have injuries.
Yeah, the next day I FaceTimed Christopher. I was walking like a pirate.
Just, God.
Like I had a peg leg. I couldn't bend it. It was rough. But we really learned a lot of the philosophy behind it, which was really good going into rehearsal. But we have a great fight choreographer, and we do fight call every night. In fact, the first day we couldn't report to the theater. We actually did remote fight call.
You did it like social distance fight call?
Yeah, but not even FaceTime. He videotaped himself doing his moves, and then I gave my move to him, and it was all
And I'm showing it on my show. Yeah. Pam Myers, what's happening?
Okay, I think I got it.
It definitely warmed up. Okay,
it is so lickety split. I don't know if I can. Well, give it a shot.
Good luck, girl.
Oh.
Don't say the word, I lost it.
If so, you'll have to come back, Pam.
Yes.
Another 100 people just got off the train and came up through the ground. Another 100 people just got off of the bus and are looking around. And another 100 people who got off the plane and are looking at us who got off the train and the plane and the bus maybe yesterday. It's a city of strangers. Some come to work, some to play. A city of strangers. Some come to stare, some to stay. And every day, the ones who stay can find each other. Private streets and the guarded park. By the rusty fountains and the dusty trees with the battered box. And they walk together past the postern walls with the crude remarks. And they meet at parties who the friends of friends who they never know. Will you pick me up or do I meet you there? Shall we let it go? Did you get my message? Because I looked in vain. Can we see each other Tuesday if it doesn't rain? Look, we'll call you in the morning or my service will explain. And another 100 people just got off of the train. It's a city of strangers. Some come to work, some to play. A city of strangers. Some come to stare, some to stay. And every day, some go away. Or they find each other in the crowded streets and the guarded parks. By the rusty mountains and the dusty trees with the battered parks. And they walk together past the postered walls with the crude remarks. And they meet at parties with the friends of friends who they never know. Will you pick me up when you meet you there, or shall we let it go? Did you get my message? Because I looked in vain. Can we see each other Tuesday if it doesn't rain? Look, I'll call you in the morning at my service. I'll explain. And another 100 people just got off of the train. Oh my word! Oh my word! Thank you. Oh, it's gonna start again. Stop! 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 Oh, I have to close that.
Oh God!
Never mind.
Fantastic. Jennifer Smart, gonna be back. We love you.
I love you.
Chris,
it was Fitz, so fun.
You're gonna be back. Chris Sieber, so many emotions seeing that.
Bye,
right,
Chris.
Man.
Pamela, so good to see you. It's been how long?
Christopher, I am not lying when I said your scene was stellar. You made me almost wet my pants. I laughed so much. It was so good. I mean it.
That's hilarious.
Jason, I miss you. I can't wait to see you soon.
I miss you too. I'll see you.
Open that damn show.
Like a fireside chat with the fireplace. And the other that is fantastic.
Happy opening.
For the show, just so you know.
Whenever it is, happy opening.
Okay, Jennifer, we love you. Chris, we love you. Pamela, what an amazing way to celebrate Sondheim. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sweetie. And
hold on. Sorry.
Mr. S.
What'd you say?
Happy birthday, Mr. S.
Happy birthday, Mr. S.
We love you.
Right. Okay, hold on. Happy birthday, Sondheim. There you go. Okay, so let me say goodbye to our stalwart of costs. Of course, Dr. John LaPook. We always bring out the dogs. Oh, hold on. Everyone is so excited because our kitty cat is making an appearance.
Oh.
We always end the show with our animals, but a certain dog is...
Ash, Jason.
Hi, Ash.
Mandy's too tired to get up.
It's late.
Yeah.
Sorry to keep everyone up so late.
We're going to go to sleep right now. You guys, thanks everyone for watching.
Dreams.
Thank you for donating.
Tomorrow at 2 p.m., we're going to celebrate Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber. And who's going to be here?
We have Sierra Boggess, Laura Benanti, Remy Caramelou, and Betty Buckley. And then tomorrow night, we've got Brian Sex Mitchell. Here come the dogs. Ah! All right, bye, everybody. Thank you.
Bye.
And broadcast, click, and broadcast.